Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Ham Nation is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This episode of Ham Nation is brought to you by NatureBox. NatureBox ships great-tasting snacks right to your door. Start snacking smarter with wholesome, delicious treats like roasted Peruvian corn kernels. To get your complimentary NatureBox sampler, visit naturebox.com/twit. That's naturebox.com/twit. And by ICOM. For more information, visit icomamerica.com/hamnation.
This is Ham Nation, episode number 182, February 4th, 2015. We visit the American Legion Amateur Radio Club. Hello, everybody. K9EID, I'm back. Yes, I'm here for at least this show. Then we're gone again, but we're really glad to be here and hope everybody's okay. We've got a great show tonight. One of the biggies is we're going to visit the official American Legion Radio Club. And you'll learn more about it. It's a fabulous club. Gordo, how are you doing? Everything okay in Costa Mesa?
Everything is fine. And we wish those that are snowbound in Milwaukee and Chicago and so on a warm-up. By the way, Milwaukee Radio Amateur Club is having this Sunday their Simplex Sprint on 2 meters and higher. So W9RomeoHotel.org is where you'll get that information. And Bob, today we're celebrating Don Arnold, W6GPS. I think it's his 200th birthday. Maybe not 200, but Donnie's way up there. So Donnie, happy birthday. And finally, Ohio, Mansfield, Ohio, February 15th, Sunday. They're having their 2,000 guests to Hamfest. Go to W8WhiskeyEcho.org to learn more. So that's what's happening in the future with a look back in a few more minutes to Quartzfest.
All right. Well, it's good to have you. And the whole slate's here tonight. Valerie's going to give us a little report on K1N. George has got his soldering iron going. But then we got to talk to Don before George takes off and burns it all up with his soldering. How you doing, Don? Everything okay in Mississippi?
Yeah, everything's great. Happy birthday to Don Arnold. Nice to see you in the chat room. I think you were on there earlier, so happy birthday. Didn't know it was your birthday. That's very cool. Yeah, everyone's trying to work K1N, and the sun may or may not give you some issues. We'll have a solar report from Dr. Tamitha Scove coming up right after the Amateur Radio Newsline headlines, Bob.
Okay, very good. Well, before we go to get the scoop from Gordo, I want to show you guys, I got this in the mail, and guess what? It's another coaxial dipole. Dave and Jenna sent me another 75 meters, so I get to put that up. But I'm telling you one thing, it's 14 degrees out here in the Ozarks. Don't look at me to do this in the next day or two. Supposed to be 70 this weekend, so maybe I'll get it done this weekend. Putting one up in another direction. Just, you know, I got room to do it. Why not? So when you have a lot of room to do things, you can do a lot of crazy things. And one of the guys that does crazy things with lots of room is Gordo. Gordo, give us the finale of the Great Quartzfest. What's going on?
Oh, it was a great show. But before we do, bulletin, no more paper ham radio licenses routinely issued by the commission. So folks like Craig and Holly of Ham Crazy have these wonderful plaques. So if you'd like to memorialize your station, get one of the plaques, because after the 17th, about 2 weeks from now, the FCC will no longer issue and send in the mail your paper upgrade license. Well, good news from Quartzfest. I'd like to thank the chat room for tearing me to pieces last week. I deserved it. I won't give you. He's got the whole world in his hands ever again, at least not for 5 minutes. But the chat room wanted to know more about how organized we would be for next year. And I'm happy to report that Quartzfest, Bob, now has a committee. Dave Anderson is heading it up, K1 Alpha November, and Heather. And this committee, we've done statistics on Quartzfest. We've looked at what they like and what they found exciting. Dave's a real detailed guy. And we've got all the stats here. And at Yuma, where we'll be in about 3 weeks, the 20th, we'll be having a meeting of the Quartzfest committee. So let's take a look do some short shots to see what happened well and what worked well at Quartzfest. Thanks to Tracy, W6ERA. Every morning, WHEM, Heather gave us Tai Chi. That was to warm us up. That's our special event, W7Q, a great antenna. And that antenna, along with a solar panel, really got us going on the air. That's Chris, and she's been running it for 5 years. Pat's helping her out. BLM Ranger came to say, now behave, you guys, at Quartzfest. No burning hams too much. Two campfire talks simultaneously, and they were packed. That's Tracy, WA6ERA, with a demonstration of his high-frequency loop. And it was neat because you could just, like, park anywhere and take in the seminars. Hey, there's Marilyn, W6MCJ, with Randy in the background talking about emergency comm. Plenty of live gear. And plenty of demos, amateur television, thanks to Gary, W6KVC, and Mike, WA6SVT, along with 10 gigahertz. Wow, we could microwave up some nice heat on that cold morning. And we did some additional testing of the Disaster Guy Titan mast, and what we discovered was it worked relatively well after we got used to it. 24 mesh nodes, web servers, and cameras all over the place. Lots of fancy antennas, and you can see it was pretty breezy out there. That's the high Q antenna with a capacity hat. There's another antenna flying the big fish, and plenty of antennas to look at. Now, here's the second hex beam. The first one at the special event station, winds up to 40 miles an hour, did not phase the hex beam. And another good-looking antenna on that rig. So lots of antennas to look at on high frequency. And there's Gary's rig, and he did ATV, so you could watch seminars all over the place. Wind generators, they were really rolling at Quartzfest. Three-element, Dr. Vern's beam, three-element beam really put out a good signal. Imagine that mobile going down the road. And there's Neil, W6FOG, with his major tower that he put up all by himself. V-beam, V-dipole antenna, very, very effective on our antenna walkabout. And here's our music man. We got to go on the side there, but we got Russ coming up shortly. But there's another antenna. There it is, the music man, Russ and Debbie's wonderful unit with a big antenna on it. And we'll learn more about Russ and the music man. This particular unit had a loop antenna all the way around the top. No, this one coming up. There it is. You can just see it. A loop throughout the entire RV. I bet he got a lot of RF on the inside. And as you can see by this, it was very, very windy. Oh, that was great. Good job, Brian. So we had a fun time despite all the wind. And whether you had a big unit or a small one, this one had solar panels throughout the top. So we scored electricity off of them. Screwdriver antennas, you can see the matching coil there at the base, the shunt fed coil. There it is, the burning sand ham before we torched it. I know, chat room, it was pretty dumb of us to be squirting igniter fluid on it. But there we go, and that was the burning ham. And, of course, we had on the final day a swap meet, and the ladies brought out some wonderful jams. And this is after the sun came up. Major swapping was even before the sun. Everybody was operating HF, you name it. And this looks like a digital station. And wow, some of the sunsets and sunrises we saw at Quartzfest is great. But next year is going to be different. We have new leadership. We have committees that are meeting at Yuma. And we'll be there on February 20 and 21 at the Yuma Hamfest. And we'll see everybody in Plano March 7th. So lots of things happening, an analytical look. And chat room, you gave us some good input, and thank you. I promise I'll never sing again on camera. And Bob, let's go back to you.
Oh, I've been trying to hear K1N, but all the signals seem to stop up the road from me. Valerie is, she's got it all wound up in that receiver up there. Not really, but I thought I'd use my Pro 7 because they got 15 of them down there, and so all the audio you're hearing from K1N is coming from the new Pro 7. We're very happy and honored by that. I've been reading some things about the American Legion Radio Club, and I read the other day that they now exceed 2,000 members. And I didn't know about it. Where have I been?
Wow.
My father was in World War II. He was in the Navy and very active in the American Legion. So I contacted the guys in Indianapolis, and wow, I was really, really stunned by what a great setup they have. So we invited them here tonight, and we'll learn a little bit more about the American Radio Club, the American Legion Radio Club, and it's in Indianapolis. And with us tonight is Marty Justis. Marty, how are you? It's glad to see you. Glad to have you with us.
Doing fine, Bob. Thank you for the invitation. We're tickled to be here, believe me.
Well, what a great station you have. We've got a few pictures, and we'll be talking over them as we go. Brian's going to start with them, and of course, there's the great logo. What a nice wall that is, and I really like that badge you have. That's kind of neat. And this is a memorial station to John Dennis. Tell us a little bit about John Dennis, Marty.
Sure, be happy to, Bob. You know, when we first started with the Amateur Radio Club, we were pretty tight for money. So we put out an invitation or a request from any of the members of our club to donate any old equipment they might have around. Well, that kind of expanded. And what happened here when John Dennis passed away, his wife got in touch with us, asked us if we would take his equipment and use it for the betterment of the club and the work of the American Legion. And we gratefully appreciate that. And so to kind of remember him, we set a position with that plaque here in our small radio room to honor him and memorialize him.
Well, that is really super. And you have this club in a really great building. And this is in downtown Indianapolis. Tell us a little bit about this building.
Sure. That's the American Legion's national headquarters. That's one of three that the American Legion operates. One's just northeast of us, and another one in Washington, D.C., where our lobbyists work from. But the one we're looking at now is the national headquarters. It houses about 100 employees here and takes care of most of the programs of the American Legion, youth-oriented programs, and certainly the American Legion Amateur Radio Club. We're down here in the basement of the building you're looking at, about 75 feet above us on the penthouse of this building are our antennae.
Well, it sure is a nice place to have a station, that's for sure. And look at this station. And you, as I understand, have two setups. You've got this one, and then there's the other one on the other side. These are both HF stations?
Actually, we run two HF positions here. We run Kenwood TS 850 and a 450, and they alternate. We use them alternately. And we also have UHF, VHF, and IRLP operations from the side that you're looking at right now.
Well, this has to be a 6-meter station. I see the grid square up there. let's check out the next one here, Brian. And you guys are hard at it. It looks like we're logging on the left and talking on the right. Tell me about the two operators and what's going on there.
Sure. The gentleman in the front's Jerry, one of the volunteers that comes in here. The gentleman in the background is myself. I'm working the microphone at that particular time, and that was during our special event on Veterans Day last November 11th. We had a record turnout, I guess I want to say, but we had more than 350 operators be in touch with us here at National Headquarters. Busy, busy day for us. We only operate for about 7 hours on that day, but we had four or five of us in here alternating, rotating through the positions, working both HF, working the UHF, VHF, and the IRLP, and Simplex.
How many operators did you say?
We have five of them kind of rotate through here, two or three at a time. What you're seeing there now is the gentleman at the UHF, VHF position. The other two of us, one of which I was at the HF position. But we rotate, kind of spread the work out a little bit. We usually have one man on the microphone, the other man logging.
Oh, that's great. Looks like a little CW work here. And this is the penthouse up, I guess, where the antennas are, correct?
It is. Actually, you're looking north out of Indianapolis. We're located at 700 North Penn, just north of the center of the city. We have a vertical there that runs our UHF, or is attached to our UHF-VHF operations, diamond vertical. We have a multi-band dipole that we run for our HF, and they're sitting up, like I said, about 70 feet, completely unobstructed to our west, pretty much to the north and the east. The south, though, we have some buildings, but we do get out particularly well out west.
Well, that's really great, and I really appreciate seeing it. And hopefully, maybe on our way over to Dayton, we can stop by and see you guys. It's a real treat to be able to let everybody know about K9TAL. Do you have any kind of net or schedule that we can all try to find?
Yes, indeed. Best thing to do would be to go on the American Legion's website, where there's a TALARC page, and that's at legion.org/hamradio. There's information there about nets, and we operate nets once a month, UHF, VHF, IRLP, and even Echolink on second Saturdays. And we do HF 40-meter net on Sundays. But the information is on the website itself, which you're looking at right now. Again, legion.org/hamradio. Any of our members are invited, and I would extend this invitation to you as well, to come in and operate our station anytime you're in town. As long as you're here between the hours of 8 and 4:30 Monday through Friday.
Well, there's one other thing I want to ask you about, and when Don was talking about it in the pre-net time here, a lot of us, our fathers, were in the war, and they're passed on, but you have a Sons of the Legions. Tell us a little bit about that, how some of us could join the American Legion and have some real meaning to what our fathers did back in the early days and try to continue that.
Well, let me say first, Bob, that those who are members of the Amateur Radio Club get their eligibility through membership in the American Legion, in the American Legion Auxiliary, as well as the Sons of the American Legion. So we welcome each and every one of you to be party to this. But those who had fathers or mothers who served in wartime, may have passed away, or maybe serving right now, are eligible to join the Sons of the American Legion. The American Legion itself, the eligibility for that is limited to wartime veterans, those who have been in the service or were in the service during those periods declared as active war periods by the United States Congress. And right now, the membership eligibility for the American Legion has been open since Desert Shield, Desert Storm back in 1990-91. So anyone who's in the military now can join. Anyone whose father is in the military now can join. And there, by the way, there is also an organization for young ladies under the American Legion Auxiliary. They can join their eligibility under their grandparents or their parents.
Well, that's really great. And I personally appreciate what you guys are doing to keep it all going. And again, it just reflects back upon what our fathers and grandfathers did for this country. And we do need more of that today to really pay respect to those guys. So thanks a lot for joining us and letting everybody here on Ham Nation know about the American Legion Radio Club. And we'll look forward to talking to each of you if we can. And please join us again sometime. We'll have you on if you have any kind of special event or whatever. Let me know, and we'll make that happen. So 7-3 to you and all there in Indianapolis, and we appreciate your time very much, Marty.
Bob, it's been our pleasure. 73 to you, and just let me make this closing remark that we will have a special event operation on Saturday, March 14th. It's the celebration of the American Legion's birthday. Hope to hear from you then. 73s to each and every one of you.
Okay, there we go. March 14th. Okay, everybody, put it down on your calendar, and we'll be looking forward to talking to K9TAL. And Don, you live in the area of their chapter 7-3. You didn't make that up, did you? Well, you can't make
I did not. Look at this. Up. This is one of my prized possessions. This is, to try to keep the reflection off of it, but this is a letter that my dad got when he got out of World War II. And it's a letter of thank you, and it's from Harry Truman, which wow. I'm sure they all got this. But this is one of my absolute prized possessions, as long as well as what I think is the 45 automatic that he carried. My dad's passed on, so there's no way I can ask him. But this gun's been in my family forever, and as a matter of fact, it has a 1915 manufacture date. So that 45 auto, which is U.S. government issue, is 100 years old this year. So, and I shoot it, and I shoot it and remember my dad every time. So yeah, it's it's very cool. Well, let's talk about NatureBox. NatureBox is a cool thing. I would show you some NatureBox stuff, but I ate it all. I'm out. But, you know, life is hectic, and you need to make the best choices that you possibly can. When you're looking for a quick pick-me-up, you need to get some delicious, healthy snacks like NatureBox. And right now, NatureBox will give you a chance. My wife is calling me. Right now, NatureBox... Pick up some NatureBox. Oh, no, you can't buy it in the store. Right now, NatureBox is giving you a chance to get a complimentary trial box of their most popular snacks. You just pay $2 shipping. And they have choices like you would not believe. Hundreds of delicious, nutritionist-approved snacks. Zero artificial flavors, colors, sweeteners, 0 grams of trans fats. No high fructose corn syrup. You'll even find snacks with the bold flavors you crave. Like the last thing I had, which was really good, is cashews, and they were like honey roasted cashews, but they were honey roasted with sriracha on them. Oh my, those were good. So in the afternoon when you're hungry, grab a NatureBox. Take it. The packages are small enough, they'll fit easily in a backpack, they'll fit easily in a jacket pocket in your desk drawer at work. Grab some chocolate banana chips, some Kung Pao pretzels, lemon pucker pistachios. How can you turn something down with the word pucker in the name? You know you're gonna snack. Do it the right way and be smart about it with NatureBox. Get your trial today. Get a complimentary sampler at naturebox.com/twit. Stay full, stay strong, stay snacking smarter. Naturebox.com/twit. NatureBox, thank you so much for your support of Ham Nation. We do appreciate you, NatureBox, and we love your snacks. Let's see what's going on in the news of the week from the Amateur Radio Newsline. Why, shall we? From Amateur Radio Newsline Report, number 1950, these are the Ham Nation headlines for Wednesday, February 4th, 2015. The FCC is going paperless. Skeeter Nash, N5ASH.
Starting February 17th, the FCC no longer will routinely issue paper license documents to amateur radio applicants and licensees. The commission has maintained for some time now that the official amateur radio license authorization is the electronic record that exists in its Universal Licensing System, or ULS, although the FCC has continued to print and mail hard copy licenses. The FCC will continue to provide paper license documents to all licensees who notify the commission that they prefer to receive one. Licensees also will be able to print out an official authorization as well as an unofficial reference copy from the ULS license manager. In comments filed November 5, 2014, the ARRL has strongly recommended that the FCC, quote, give serious consideration to continuing a default provision for sending an initial paper license document to new licensees in the amateur radio service, along with detailed, simple instructions for how to make the elections set forth in the notice relative to future modified or renewed licenses, end quote.
As always, there's much more to the story, and you can read and hear more in the full edition of this week's Amateur Radio Newsline. There's more activity from the sun. Here's Hal Rogers, K8CMD.
Spaceweather.com says a geomagnetic storm erupted during the early days of January 26th, sparking a surprise display of bright auroras around the Arctic Circle. Scientists took the opportunity to launch 4 sounding rockets from Alaska's Poker Flat Research Range to study the effect of the solar storms on the upper atmosphere. Pictures of the colorful launch are available at spaceweather.com.
Ham Radio in the News. The emergency operating capabilities of amateur radio were featured as part of WABC-TV, New York City's annual Operation 7 Save a Life special that aired Saturday, January 24th.
The ARRL contributed video from W1AW and Broadcast Employees Amateur Radio Society President Howard Price, KA2QPJ, was interviewed. Price also demonstrated the operating capabilities of the Broadcast Employees Amateur Radio Service Communications Van. The Broadcast Employees Amateur Radio, or BEARS, operates the flagship repeater for New York City Aries. It also maintains a large multi-state repeater system known as the Disney Amateur Radio Interconnect, which links affiliated repeaters in Massachusetts, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Greater Washington, D.C., Pennsylvania, Florida, and California. The Operation 7 specials each year are dedicated to emergency preparedness, and this is the first year in the long history of these shows that spotlights ham radio.
You can see the ham radio segment at the URL in this week's printed edition of the Amateur Radio Newsline. And the March 2015 edition of American Legion magazine will include a feature article about the hobby of amateur radio.
Written by best-selling author Don Keith, N4KC, the article explains how ham radio remains exciting, important, and relevant even after 100 years of existence and so much technological change. It also reminds American Legion members about their organization's own club, the American Legion Amateur Radio Club, or TALARC, as well as how its members can get their licenses, establish club stations at more of the 14,000 posts around the country, and more. The Legion has an agreement with the Department of Homeland Security for assistance during emergencies, and the article talks about how amateur radio meshes well with that effort. American Legion magazine is distributed to that veterans organization's 2.3 million members, as well as through other outlets. TALARC now has more than 2,000 members. Regular on-air nets are held for Legion members who are also hams. The club station, K9TAL, at American Legion headquarters in Indianapolis, Indiana, also hosts regular operating events.
And that's all from the Amateur Radio Newsline, your independent source for amateur radio news for over 37 years and counting at www.arnewsline.org. For Bill Pasternak, WA6ITF, Skeeter Nash, N5ASH, and Hal Rogers, K8CMD, I'm Don Wilbanks, AE5DW73. We'll see you next time here on Ham Nation. All right, good stuff. And just some quick information. Bill is out of the hospital, which is good news. He's in a rehab facility for the next couple of weeks or couple of months, whenever. Hopefully, we'll be home soon. But he's back to posting on Facebook, which is really, really good. You know, with K1N Navassa Island on the air, the sun has been acting up a little bit. And we've got Dr. Tamitha Scove to tell us a little bit more about that right now.
Hi, I'm Tamitha Scove with your solar storm forecast for the week of February 4th. The sun has been moderately flare active over the past week or so, mainly because of two regions, region 2268 and 2277. Those two have been giving us low-level M-class flares. They get active for a little while, and then they die back down, and then they get active again for another couple days, and they die back down. But they refuse to go away, so we're continuing to watch them. What also is interesting is the east limb of the sun is showing some serious activity. Some solar storms have been flying off, and we also have some very interesting filaments that might be erupting soon. We also have this southern coronal hole down here that's given us a few Earth-directed wispy storms, but nothing dramatic yet. Switching to our storm levels, we really haven't seen much in the way of solar storms other than fast wind that's come from coronal holes, and that's managed to keep us at about unsettled conditions to active conditions over the course of the past 2 weeks. Although we did the other day hit a very fast solar wind stream that popped us over storm level conditions, and that kind of rattled the shield a little bit. So we've actually had maybe some bad ham radio propagation over the past few days. Switching to our solar storm conditions and aurora possibilities over the next few days, NOAA is expecting active conditions with about a 35% chance of a major storm at high latitudes, tapering off to about a 30% chance for a minor storm over the next few days until we get out of that high-speed stream. At mid-latitudes, we're expecting unsettled conditions with about a 15 to 30% chance of activity over the next few days. Now, we do have a solar storm that is going to pass us to the east, and if it hits us or we see any wake at all, it'll be on February 6th into February 7th. So we're anticipating that there might be a little bit more of a enhanced storm condition levels on the 6th through the 7th, but then it should be tapering off after that. So this week looks to have a lot of potential for continued flare activity. We have regions 2277 and 2280 that are growing quite rapidly right now, and they could cause continued M flares over the next few days. And that would affect you ham and amateur radio operators, causing disruptions in your propagation from time to time. I'm Tam of the Scove. Thank you for watching.
All right, good stuff. And you see that spaceweather.tv, that is a brand new website that that she has started. And it's ran by a ham. So, you know, there's going to be a lot of ham radio stuff on there. And there's actually going to be a ham radio section on there. It's live now. You can go to spaceweather.tv. And you can also go to the Amateur Radio Newsline Facebook page, and you can see about a one-minute neat little video that she put together of a whole bunch of auroral activity that we've been talking about. The high-latitude aurora has been just amazing, and there's some really, really neat stuff. So you need to go check those videos out. But right now, and thank you, Dr. Scove. We do appreciate you, and we're going to try to get her on live for an interview here as soon as time and schedules will allow. But first, I think we need to head a couple of hours to my north, and is that solder smoke I smell? George, are you up to it again?
Did it smell like rosin? If it did, then it was.
That's a loaded question.
Yeah, good to be back again. We're looking at the test pattern behind me. You see the little line going across here, right over my shoulder? That is 800 right there next to my neck. If you can see those little lines right there, then you've got a super good resolution on your web stream there. I can see it here, but I doubt it gets through MPEG and all of that very well. But anyway, I got a little smoke and solder tonight, but I did want to mention before we got into it that we had the first official episode of Ham Nation this past week. It's posted now. Ham College, not Ham Nation. This is episode 182 of Ham Nation, so I'm a little behind on that. But the first official episode of Ham College, episode 1, hamcollege.tv. You can go check it out there. We also did a pilot episode back in November, but it's a show for new hams or those wanting to become hams. So go check it out and let us know what you think. You know, Don, I listened for K1N here earlier today on 10 meters. Couldn't hear him here, but I could sure hear a pileup calling after him. So I'm going to have to keep check on the web there and see where they're operating and check on that some more, because that could make some good context in my logbook there. Well, let's get on into the segment tonight. You know, back in December of 2012, episode 48 of Amateur Logic, I talked a little bit about how to set up an HF station for those who maybe didn't know it. So let's take a little review on that, and we got something a little special at the end of it, too. Today we're going to do something that many new hams will need to know how to do. Some of you old-timers already know all of this, but watch anyway, because you might pick up a tip along the way that you had forgotten about. What are we going to do? Well, we're going to set up an HF station. If you've never done it before, I'm sure that you're going to find something useful here. Now, the first thing you're going to need is a place to set up your HF station. We're going to do it here on this table. That's as good a place as any for this demonstration. But at home, you might want to look around, maybe use a computer desk, a table, you know, whatever you've got available. Just make sure you got enough room for your gear and some room that you can sit your logbook down and do some writing on. Maybe do a little working on cables or whatever might be necessary. If you got a little desk space left over for that, that's great. Also, leave a little room around your equipment for ventilation. You don't want to pack it in too tight and it overheat. So once you've selected your location, the next thing we probably should think about is grounding. Now, I got in trouble the last time I talked about grounding over on smoke and solder. I'm going to show you my ground system. This is how I do it. I start with a ground rod. This is an 8-foot ground rod driven into the ground right outside my shack, actually right up under it. And I've got this piece of copper strap that comes up into the building, and that's where I connect my radio and my tuner and all the gear that I've got. Now, if you don't have copper strap, you can find that at Georgia Copper or a number of different places. But if you don't want to spend that kind of money, you can use something else like aluminum flashing, some wide braid, maybe some braid off some RG8 coax if that's the best you can get. And if you can't do that, then perhaps just a heavy gauge piece of wire, but wire would be my last choice for this. Every HF radio is going to have a ground screw on the back of it. I'm going to remove this on my HF rig. I actually have copper strap coming up to this, but for this demonstration, we're going to use some braid here, which would make a great ground. Now, most of these are going to have two washers on the screw. What we want to do is leave one of those washers down on the screw itself. Then we'll put our braid, and then we'll put the other washer. That way, it doesn't try to twist the braid as we turn the screw. Rather than try to twist the braid around there, I'm just going to take a little awl here, punch a hole in it, stick the screw through, put the washer on, and we'll tighten that down good. And we want to be sure that none of this braid is going to get up in here and get mixed in with our power connector. That would be bad. Now this other end of the braid goes to our ground system. Now let's take a moment to talk about antennas. Of course, you're going to have an antenna for any radio. On HF radios, the antennas get kind of large because of the long wavelength that we're dealing with. Now there's all types of choices. There's vertical antennas, inverted Vs, loops, beams, just a myriad of choices. The off-center fed dipole. This particular one is cut for 80 meters, but it will also work 40 meters, and some of the others will work more bands than that. Let's go outside and look at my antennas. Here's a 40-meter off-center fed dipole that I've got up in the backyard. I've got a lot of pecan trees back here, and those things have limbs just everywhere, so there was no way I could stretch this antenna out straight. So you'll notice that I've got several bends in it, and that's okay. Straight would be better. However, whatever works, you know, whatever you can get up in the air is going to be better than no antenna, and this one works pretty decent. You can see I've used ropes at either end of it. Now, I've used this green rope here with a little braid pattern in it that I picked up at Lowe's. I don't remember the exact type, polyethylene, polypropylene, I'm not sure. But if you go look at Lowe's or some hardware store, it's a different types of rope. You'll see on there which ones are UV resistant and weather resistant. That's the one you want to get. I've had these up for several years and have had absolutely no problems out of them. Now let's talk a little bit about coax. You can use ladder line to feed HF antennas, and that's a great way to go. Some people swear by it, and that's all they'll use. I generally use coax cable. I've just had good luck with it. You'll see there's a braid around the outside, then the center insulation here, and the center conductor. And most every ham antenna will fit a PL259 if the cable just doesn't connect directly to the antenna. Also, this is what fits practically every amateur radio transceiver. We'll have one of these on either end of our feed line. Now, this is RG213 here. RG8 is about the same size of cable. 213 has slightly less loss to it, and that's generally what I use. Now, you could go with something smaller if you're running 100 watts, which a typical HF station has. RG58 or Mini-8 would be fine for HF frequencies. If you're running high power or a linear amplifier, you'll definitely want to go with some larger coax. Now let's talk about connecting this cable to your antenna. You'll notice on the PL259, it may be hard to see here, there's two little protrusions here. And if you notice on the coax connector, on the SO239, there's all these little serrated edges around here. The point is that when you slide the cable in here, you want to make the protrusion on the PL259 fit down inside two of the grooves there in the SO239. Then, of course, we just screw it down good and tight. And you might want to take a pair of pliers and get this extra tight. But wiggle the back of the connector here to make sure that you've got the two protrusions down in the holes there. Then tighten it up. Okay, once we've got that tight, we still got something else we need to do, and that is weatherproof this. Because if you leave it like this, you're going to get water in it. and you're just asking for trouble in the future. If you're just going to use electric tape, I recommend Scotch 88. Scotch 33 will work as well, but 88's a little bit thicker and a little more rugged. So I would take this and wrap it good all the way around the connector here, all the way as tight as I could get it up against the end here, and then come back out down the cable for a little ways past the connector. And I would probably put two or three layers on there and wrap it as tight as you can get it. Now, at that point, there's a few options you have. A lot of people like to use coax seal. I definitely want to put on the electric tape before I would put coax seal on here. So if you ever have to take this apart, you can peel it back and pull the tape off, and you've got a fairly clean connector. If you put coax seal on there, you'll never get it all off. There's another option or two that you could use. And one is, after you've put on the electric tape, you might want to try something like liquid electric tape. This stuff seems to be pretty good. I haven't been using it long, so I don't have a lot of experience with it yet. But a good two or three coatings, maybe even four coatings of that on top of your electric tape, particularly around the ends, would probably keep you weatherproof. But the thing that I usually use is this Scotch rubber splicing tape. I'll put this on first. Now, this stuff looks sort of like electric tape, but it's a lot thicker. It's not really sticky. It's this one particular model here has a liner on the back that you have to peel off. But you wrap this thing around as tight as you can and make a couple of good layers of that, overlapping them good, though, so that you don't have any grooves where water can get in. And this stuff really stretches. And as you wrap it around there, it kind of fuses to itself and gives you a really good water seal. After I put on my rubber splicing tape here, then I will cover that with Scotch 88. And that's how I do all my antennas, and I really haven't had a problem with them. But it's something, you know, that might take a little playing with. Just look at it close and make sure that you've got everything covered and you can't get water in there, and you should be okay.
Calling all amateur radio operators and CBers.
Now you can increase your effective radiated power and signal strength without adding expensive extra equipment, thanks to a recently discovered cache of secret 1960s military documents. Originally developed by the Department of Defense for use with handheld field transceivers, this closely guarded secret was able to increase the range by a magnitude of over 3 times. This revolutionary material has been synthesized using the latest computer-aided development for production by Fu Yu Technology Company of China. Now you can purchase the amazing RF grease in small quantities for personal use.
As long as the FCC does not find out.
RF grease causes your signal to slide in and out of your antenna faster. This greatly reduces RF friction and results in lower SWR readings, increased field strength, and overall improved RF inertia. Because of the greatly increased radiation speed, some early RF grease adopters report their signal being heard on the other side of the globe before they even began transmitting. You too can get 4 to 5 dB of extra gain, increased stamina, and libido with just one application. We'll even give away the first month's trial supply for free for the first 20 respondees. Go to www.fuyu.com right now and order your supply of RF grease today.
And the RF grease really helps out. Your signal will go faster than the speed of light then.
I've got an account at that place.
You do.
And let me tell you something. I've used that RF grease.
I've used that RF grease, and it does not work. I ate a whole tube of that stuff, and nothing happened.
You're supposed to put it in your hair, Don.
Oh. Let me tell you something, George. You're just really... You should really be happy that Gordo has left the building to go teach another class. You know that.
Yeah, I do. I saved it up till he left. Yeah, good stuff. If you can find it, you should buy some.
Yeah.
Yeah, only if you can find it. Well, you know, last week I asked a question. What did Don say he wanted at the Hamfest? You know, we had a little footage from the Capital City Hamfest. Well... Actually, Don said he wanted more than one thing.
I know that one. I know
that
one.
You do know that one.
I know that one.
Well, you might have the wrong answer. So I'm going to tell you the one that I got from Tommy Graham, KK4PZF. And he said Don wanted a Raspberry Pi. Is that right, Don?
Yes.
Okay. I was thinking you wanted a Swan 500CX. But then I remembered you wanted a Raspberry Pi too. So
I would accept any of those answers is correct.
Yeah. So we're going to send this to Tommy. This is the Boy Scouts Merit Badge Series Radio Merit Badge book. It's really got some good stuff in there, interesting things. And I would suggest, Tommy, you read this book yourself and then give it to a Boy Scout, because there's some good things in there. For next week, though, we've got another question. What is another name for the antenna that I just showed you there? If you think you know the answer, then send it to me at hamnationcontest@gmail.com. And you could win this MFJ 12 24-hour dual LCD clock. You set one to your local time, and that's the 12-hour one. Set the other to UTC, that's 24-hour one, and you'll always know what time it is. Perfect for the ham shack. So hamnationcontest@gmail.com, and you could win that. Well, now I think we need to go and check with Valerie, because I understand you've got something special for us tonight, don't you, Val?
Hi, yes. And by the way, George, you know, if you need to work K1N, you can always come up here. I'm all alone. Make sure to bring some RF grease, though.
Okay, that'll help.
Yeah, tonight I'm going to talk about 2D expeditions going on, or that were. One was the Malpelo D expedition. Now, this happened 3 years ago, and I've got a video. It's not exactly short, but I have a video on that D expedition. And then I'm going to update you guys on the latest, what's going on with Navassa K1N. Now, this Malpelo D expedition, this occurred back in 2012. And for those of you who don't know about Malpelo, that was HK0NA. And it is a large volcanic rock protruding out of the Pacific, and it's owned by Colombia. And the conditions on this island are very difficult. So I hope you enjoy the video. We're going to take a look at HK0NA, and that's the Malpelo D expedition in 2012. Now, this is a tiny island or rock off the coast of Colombia, and it was number 12 on the most wanted DXCC list, but not anymore. They actually broke a record for tent and generator. Now, this D expedition actually began at Christmas of 2011 when the advance team departed for Malpelo with all of the equipment. Now, they're going to be spending the next 6 weeks on this island, and they're called the Fabulous Four. And they are Bomar, HK1 Mike Whiskey, Jaime, HK1 November, Salim, HK1 Tango, and Faber, HK6 Foxtrot. And here they are unloading and setting up all the equipment weeks in advance of the rest of the team arriving on the island. They had a lot of antennas to put up, and it's in extreme heat. And since Malpelo is basically a rock, it's very challenging to anchor the guy wires for all these antennas. And the Fabulous Four did manage to get everything set up and installed in advance of the rest of the team arriving on January 18th.
Hi, Bob.
Hi, Bob.
This is the airport of Buenaventura. This is considered the drug capital of the world, cocaine capital of the world. And this looks like an army base here.
Thank you.
We talk about the problems of the former Malpelo D expeditions, and the biggest problem was that nobody has set up a camp or an antennas at the top of the mountain. Everybody stay near the army facilities, and that makes that all the antennas was partially blocked for the mountains. With the signals coming from Asia and the West Coast from the United States. So Bob says that we need to put an antenna at the top. And I remember that I said, well, we're going to put an antenna at the top in one way or another. So,
pero si suelta la del brazo ya para que esté más claro. Allá todo.
Suéltalo y no.
Bueno, ¿voy amarrando qué, pues?
Cuidado.
No se termina.
We are testing the station here from the operation side at the top of the hill of the mountain, and you are the first contact from here. So we are testing the antenna here and the radio. We are running only with 100 watts into the A3WS by Coastcraft, and there are 300 meters above the sea level. I'm going to start to calling, working on a split, listening up. November 6th, Papa Radio X-ray, Hotel Kilowatt Zero, Norway Alpha. Thanks a lot. Kilo Juliet, 509. Yeah, but the California station, the Kilo Juliet 4, I need your suffix again, or?
Yeah, Kilo Juliet 6, Papa, Kilowatt, Japan, 6 Portugal, Kilo, Papa, 6, Papa, Kuzet.
Roger, Kilo Japan 6, Papa, you're 5 and 9, thanks. The 7 Victor 59. Roger, November Lima 7, Victor 59, thanks.
This is our ninth day. This is the scene all day long, 24 hours a day. For 9 days, we've got 4 more to go. Pretty amazing, these guys just sit there and knock out the contacts. Pretty doggone amazing. I think some of my friends would think this is kind of crazy. Might even refer to these guys as hemaholics.
Thank you.
Romeo 59.
Sierra Alpha 59, 73s and 88s, Whiskey Yankee 3 Romeo.
30 kilo
4.
Hello, Bob. How are you?
Well, trying to catch my breath, boy.
Yeah? The fine mess you got us into, K4UE.
Hello, Bob. Welcome to off the top of my pillow.
View from the top of the island where Op A is located, and we're looking at the western side of Malpelo. And this is the top of a 12,000 foot mountain. It's just the last 900 feet, the other 11,100 feet go down to the ocean floor. Really a rugged place. Really, really rugged.
I believe it was like 110 degrees here one day, and boy, it was hot. Humidity was high, the bugs are bad, the pileups are great, and it's been a great experience so far.
Radio's been good. We've had some really good pileups. Have enjoyed that. Meeting a lot of new people from South America. It's been really good with those guys. And I've been doing the same thing I've done on previous D expeditions, sending up logs, sending up pictures, and taking care of the team email. Couldn't have asked for better, except for the heat. It could have been a lot cooler.
I'm an orthopedic surgeon, and my biggest concern has been injuries and falls, slips, cuts from the very sharp rocks. When it rains, like it's done a few times, there's an algae that's covering the rock, along with guano, and that just changes to slime.
Well, we're finally leaving. Been here 15, 16 days, I'll count later. But this is significantly easier going down than it was coming up. I remember some 2 weeks ago, I had to stop about 8 times to rest. But still, it's pretty dangerous, so it's slow going down as well, not necessarily any faster. Got to be sure you've got good solid footing.
Nadie como tú, baila lo alo, nadie como tú, baila lo alo, nadie como tú. Baila el bugalú, nadie como tú. Baila el bugalú. Nadie como tú. Baila el bugalú, nadie como tú. Baila el bugalú. Nadie como tú, baila el bugalú, nadie como tú.
Bugalú,
tú ven a bailar limbo.
Bugalú,
no tengas miedo del fuego.
Bugalú,
no se pierde la ilusión.
Bugalú,
como un dentro de limbo drum.
Hope you guys enjoyed that. So you can see that they are not very pleasant. Some of these de-expeditions, they're not exactly a vacation. And K4UE has a whole bunch of de-expeditions expedition videos you can buy on his website, which would be great to bring to your next club meeting, maybe show one of those. This video is actually an hour long that I kind of chopped down for you guys here. Now we're going to switch gears and we're going to talk about the K1N or Navassa de-expedition going on right now. I just talked to Jerry via sat phone about 4 hours ago and everybody's doing well in spite of the heat. It's been very hot and humid there. When I talked to him 4 hours ago, they actually had 22,000 QSOs in the logs right now. And for those of you that were waiting for Club Log to get updated, it did get updated earlier today, so you can go on there and check that out. They're going to try and update twice a day, but at least once a day for everybody out there. And I also wanted to make note that in the early stages, they didn't have all their step IRs up, so a lot of them were working with wires down there. So they may have been working North America only, and it looked a little out of balance. But now that they got the step IRs up, they're going to start to be able to work more Europe, Oceania, Asia, and even the numbers out a little bit for Navassa. So thanks for your patience on that. And also, I know I talked about this 2 weeks ago, and I'm sorry to hammer it, but I've been listening to these pileups. And again, one more thing I'm going to state, please make sure your split button's on. Make sure you don't tune up on the K1N transmitting frequency. I mean, preferably tune up into a dummy load if you can, or at least on an empty frequency. And make sure you listen. I heard the other day they were calling for, you know, only North America west of the Mississippi, and there was a lot of people calling them that shouldn't have. So if you everybody listens and follows their instructions, these guys can get those rates up. These guys can work 200 to 300 people an hour if everybody listens to them and obeys and doesn't tune up on frequency and things like that. And if they can get to that rate, we'll all get in the log and we'll all be happy. So I wanted to say that. Now, I did talk to Jerry yesterday. They do not have enough amps to go around, so he came up about 9 o'clock central time, my time here, and 300 Zulu, and he only had 100 watts because they don't have enough amps to go around. But I did record this right after our cue, so I did record a little video of Jerry working 20 sideband, and you can hear that they have a pretty good signal for only 100 watts now. That's here to the States. They will be shuffling things around and putting other amps on different stations. So if you didn't hear them on 20 meters yesterday, don't worry. You may hear them tonight or tomorrow night once they get some power behind it. But if you want to go ahead and roll that little bitty video for me. So that was pretty good for only 100 watts. Again, I'm here in Illinois, and I do have a monster stack. I have 6 over 6 over 6 at 180, 120, and 60 feet, so that helps a little as well. But again, they hopefully will get some power, and they're going to keep moving those amps around so they can work the further stations on different bands. Also, I have some the latest photos from Navassa. If you want to go ahead and start showing some of those photos for me, Brian. There's George. He's waving in the helicopter, the next helicopter. They have one more helicopter to arrive, so that'll be tomorrow. There they are cleaning out the lighthouse. Now, there's not a lot of trees or cover on this island, but they did manage to find trees growing inside the lighthouse there. They had to kind of chop them down and clean it out and put up some stations. There's one station getting ready to be set up inside the lighthouse. And there's the outside of the lighthouse. And there's also those meet and greet tents there. That's where everybody kind of hangs and eats. There's Ralph Fedor, Dr. Ralph Fedor, K0IR. There's two doctors who are hams on this island. And no, that's not a dungeon. That's them operating from inside the lighthouse. Looks pretty doom and gloom, and I bet it's really hot in there. That 112 degrees, that was actually the coolest temperature they've endured so far. Yesterday, it got up to 116 degrees. Not only that, they put some traps out around their food, and they've caught rats the size of cats, so I'm told. And they have scorpions and black widow spiders to deal with. Now, I wanted to talk to you also about this DQRM thing. You know, if everybody's been noticing, the deliberate QRM has been out of control on a lot of de-expeditions more and more recently. So what they decided to do, if you go to NevasaDX.com, they do have a DQRM tab there. If you click on that, if you hear any deliberate QRM, they're asking you to fill this out. You don't have to leave your name and your call sign, but you do have to give your grid square. You do have to give your beam heading and the signal levels that you experience from both the deliberate QRMer and the Nevasa Island operator. And hopefully, if another people fill this out, they will be able to triangulate some of that deliberate QRM. And maybe knowing that this is there and people are completing this and filling this out, maybe it'll stop deliberate QRMing from even happening. So if you do experience it, I encourage you to go to the NevasaDX.com and fill that out. And I know I ran long, so I don't really have a contesting report, but I promise in 2 weeks I will get you updated on upcoming contests, other DX going on, and maybe some IOTAs and things like that. So right now I am going to pass it over to, we're going to hear all about ICOM.
From new models to classic radios, there's something for everyone this season. So get out or hunker down with ICOM. Celebrate ICOM's 50th year with the IC7850. Only 150 units are available, and each radio features 1.2 kHz optimized roofing filter, a new local oscillator design with improved phase noise, several spectrum scope enhancements, and distinct gold accents on the front panel and commemorative label. For contesters just starting out this year, ICOM's IC7600. You get advanced DSP technology and IF roofing filters, dual watch on the same band on an ultra-wide 5.8-inch display. Got cabin fever and need to get away? Get mobile with ICOM's IC2730A and ID5100A. The analog 2730A mobile and digital 5100A with built-in GPS. Both feature optional Bluetooth capability for hands-free operation, 50 watts output power on both VHF and UHF, and a large backlit screen. For entry-level D-Star operation, take the ID880H on the road. Features include a good menu structure and VHF-UHF dual-band functionality, one band at a time. To hunker down or get out, the ID51A Plus is a perfect radio to enjoy global communications. This dual-bander has the free downloadable RSMS1A Android app, enhanced DV functionality, and additional D-Plus reflector link commands. Make sure you visit icomamerica.com/amateur for more information on ICOM's base stations, mobiles, and portables. And you can tune in and enter to win after each episode of Ham Nation. Go to icomamerica.com/hamnation. Throw your name in the hat for some great swag prizes like T-shirts and hats, and also learn how you can win in the monthly grand prize drawing for a new radio. Go to icomamerica.com/hamnation for official rules and to check out all of ICOM's previous drawing winners, like the January grand prize winner, Dale Northcutt from Montgomery, Illinois, N6SFU, and he won the new IC2730A dual-band mobile rig. And for February, we've got another grand prize. That's going to be the ID51A+. It's a 5-watt dual-band dual-watch handy-talkie with D-Star, integrated GPS, automatic repeater list-up, and a lot more. So go to icomamerica.com/hamnation after this episode and each episode of Ham Nation and register to win. And now it's time to bring in Val and see what's been going on in the chat room this week.
Well, I'm sure Val would love to answer those questions. That's funny. That's
yeah, okay. I'm sure she would. I got a little too much RF grease a while ago. I'm sorry, Amanda.
That's okay. You didn't know it was Ham College, Ham Nation? No, I'm kidding. It's all right. You got a lot going on there. So anyhow, George, thanks so much. And don't go away because I've got some questions for you right now. By the way, you guys, since George was talking about things to wrap up your connections with, try this for your outdoor stuff. They call it monkey goo, maybe. Ugh. It's pretty messy stuff. So don't use it unless you never plan on taking your connections apart. Yeah. Anyhow, George, one question for you. KE0ARB Steve would like to know, what is best, using an internal antenna tuner or an external antenna tuner? What do you think?
If you need to use a tuner, you can try the internal. That might work. The big difference between the two is the external antenna tuners will generally tune a broader range. So if your antenna is a little farther off resonance, you got a better chance that an external tuner can bring it in. But the internal ones will work maybe just to a more limited degree. Maybe 5-1 or something like that. It might bring it back in.
Very good. Thanks so much for that. I appreciate that. And so I don't have any specific questions for anybody, so I'm just going to send one to Bob. Thanks, Bob, for being here tonight. So nice to have you on the show. It was cool that you popped in last week. That was fun. Anyhow, Chris, KD8YVJ wants to know, he's only a tech, so he's only on 10 meters on HF. Wondering if any of you guys, and I'll send it to you first, Bob, do you get on just randomly on 10 meters? And if so, when?
I do, but I don't have any special time. Hey, listen, guys, here's K1N. I mean, they're really, are really coming out. And there's something I want to tell you about. Just let him go here.
Thank you. 73 is running 100 watts here. You are said this is Kilo November, K1 Nevada, listening.
Now, did you hear him say listening 240, 250? I don't know what the deal is, but the DX expeditions and contesting, usually they will do splits. What that means, he's transmitting on 155, but don't you transmit there. I don't understand it. A while ago, there was a pile up on 155. He's not listening there. He's listening up at 240 and up to 250. I just wanted you to hear that. What a great signal in here with 100 watts.
And he does sound good.
But the split thing, it really bugs me. When guys don't understand that, or they just want to be a jerk, it doesn't do anything because he's very strong. I can't imagine what he's going to be with an amplifier, but I will have to say it. You can hear how sharp and clean his audio is. That's why we develop microphones that sound like that. No, they're not great for rag chew all the time because they're in your face, but that's why we do that. But I just wanted to do a little side note. I know Val's over there smiling because this has to be told to the whole fraternity to take care of those splits. But yes, Amanda, I'm on 10 meters, but I have to tell you, most of the time when I'm there, I'm on AM, 29.0 to 29.1 or so, and a lot of AM activity up there. But I do get down on sideband, but I don't have any specific time. So send me an email or let me know, and we'll charge up there and see you guys. Back to you, Amanda.
Very good. I'm the same way. Kind of just look at some spots. If it's open, I tend to just tune around and listen or work some people. If I hear someone calling CQ, hey, I'm going to answer them. Unless they're calling for CQ DX. And then, no, I won't answer them because I'm just going to irritate them. But yeah, the split thing is very difficult. I don't know where people don't get that. And it's funny to listen to. You hear a bunch of people come in there, they're working split, and they're yelling at you. So just get it together. Anyhow, okay, couple more questions. This one I looked up so I would have the answer correct so I wouldn't have to put anyone on the spot. After having the American Legion on here, which was wonderful, by the way, a lot of people in the chat room started talking about, hey, so how about the Navajo Code Talkers, and are any of them still alive? Well, I did look it up, and of all of the original Navajo Code Talkers, the last one died June 24th of 2014. So that's pretty sad. So that might mean that there's not the original Code Talkers, but there are still some Code Talkers out there, which is still pretty cool. After that, I did have a question or two for Val, but she had to go. And so I'll just send this out randomly. Maybe Dawn can answer this. Jeremy, VA3ZTF, would like to know if he makes a contact with a contester, does he have to upload his logs for that contact to count for the contester? Don, do you know?
I'm thinking. Off the top of my head, I'm not sure because I'm not really a contester. Val would be able to answer that question, but I would think that... I don't think so. I think it, I don't know. I don't know.
Okay.
And as far as 10 meters, if anybody ever wants to set up a schedule with me, catch me on Facebook or email me. Just look my email up on QRZ or whatever, and I'll be happy to get on with anyone.
Now that's pretty cool, Don. Of course, you're a cool guy. We appreciate that. And I will table that question for Val again. Jeremy,
hey,
I'm so
Amanda?
Sorry. No. Yeah, go ahead, George.
Ray N9JA says that the logs are encouraged, but they're not required.
There you go.
There you go. So that's a great answer. Thank you. And George, what about you? Do you get on 10 meters?
I don't get on it very often. Usually if I get on 10 meters, it's when I'm driving and maybe I'm going to be in the truck a little longer and I'll tune around. If 10 meters is open, I'll get on it and talk a little bit. And I've had some really good luck on there for mobile using the same rig and antenna that Don uses.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be what?
The IC7000 and the little Tar Heel 2 screwdriver antenna. Because then you can just tune around to whatever band you want real quick without pulling off the road and doing a lot of stuff.
It's a good combo.
Yep. Very good. It does sound fun. I have never done any mobile HF stuff. That would be cool. Of course, Don, you drive quite a few miles to work. Is that why you do a lot of HF mobile?
Well, I used to. I don't have the... I'm getting ready to sell the Jeep, so the radio is out of the Jeep. And, you know, I wrecked the Toyota, and that was the one that the radio was in, the 7000 was in. I don't have... I have a Firebird now. I have a 2001 Firebird. And there's a lot of fiberglass on that car, and there's, like, very little room inside. So I do not have a radio in that car right now. But I was doing a lot of HF when I was driving back and forth. Let me tell you something. HF mobile is fun. I remember when I was just a five-word-a-minute tech, a tech plus, I had a little 25-watt Uniden, HR2510, I think it was, and a CB antenna on the back. I think it was it a K40? Whatever it was. It was a CB whip on the back of my truck. Summertime, and I talked from New Orleans to Australia and to Japan, and that was just the coolest thing on 25 watts. The coolest mobile contact I ever made was 100 watts on 20 meters with an ICOM 706 Mark IIG into an Outbacker Perth Plus, and I had a real nice conversation with McMurdo Station Antarctica on 20 from my truck using 100 watts. So HF mobile is a lot of fun, but ground is everything.
Absolutely. So, Mr. Bob, oh, I can't call you Mr. Bob anymore. You're Dr. Bob.
Dr. Bob.
Dr. Bob, what are your travels bringing you next? Where are you going?
Oh, who knows? We never know. I have to talk to my social director, Sarah, and see what's coming up.
But, very we'll good. Around. Well, hey, you guys, I've had a lot of fun tonight. Great show. A lot of info tonight. And, George, great video about grounding. I definitely learned a lot. What do you think, George?
I'm always leery to talk about grounding on here because there's a lot of different opinions on that subject. So I did have a little disclaimer in there about that.
Very good. Well, hey, you guys, that's the questions I've got tonight. And that's it. That's my segment for tonight. So I'll send it back to Dr. Bob.
Well, thanks, and it's really great. Yeah, it was wonderful tonight. And George, I won't get into that, but you know, I have all these, I don't know, 30, 40 pieces of equipment. No ground, but we'll talk about that later. The tower's grounded, balanced audio, balanced antennas, don't need ground. Never have my whole amateur radio career, but we'll get into that another time. WB2WIK, look him up on probably Eham. He's got some great articles about grounding. We will see you all here next week. It's been really, really great. And let's see. I got a thing. What's going to be 14C tonight, George? Is that right?
Yeah, D-Star is reflector 14, module C, Echo Link Star, do drop in Star, node number 355-800. Cheryl is on 80 meters at 3847. 20 meters is at 14.268, and 40 meters, I'm not sure. I think they're around 7.278, somewhere around there.
And I understand that we can listen to the D-Star audio on hamnationstar.net.
Hamnationdstar.net.
Yeah, okay.
And that's pretty neat. Some people don't have D-Star radios, and that's a good way to listen.
Absolutely. Well, we'll sign this off for tonight. I'm going to go listen to some more 14.155, and we'll talk to you all later. Thanks for joining us here on Ham Nation. share the excitement and the knowledge that happens here every week with your friends and clubs. And we're doing a couple of club meetings on Skype. If you have an active club, why George, Gordo, myself, we don't do them together, but we come in and join your club on Skype. It's really good stuff because we need some activity in clubs today, and this is a nice way to do it. No cost, and boy, lots of info. So we will see you next week. Thanks, Brian. Thanks to Leo Laporte and everybody to give us this bandwidth and the time. Thanks to all the sponsors. We'll see you on the air somewhere, a little high, a little low, but we'll be there. Good night for now. This is K9EID.